We can start with the last seminar of this afternoon session. Our speaker is Paolo Antonelli from Grand Sasso Science Institute. Today we will talk about global intelligence solution for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system. So please, Paolo.
Thank you. So thank you, Raffaele, for the introduction. And first of all, let me also thank personally the organizers of this workshop, Raffaele, Alessandro, and Vladimir. First of all, for organizing it, and then anyway, for the great effort in keeping this hybrid form of the workshop, despite of the difficulties. I know it's difficult, and I really appreciate the effort. So, and indeed, I'm sorry, I cannot be there personally, and I could just participate online, even if I'm close by because I'm in L'Aquila, but because of some other reasons, let's say I could not come. So thanks again for the organization and for the possibility to anyway to give a talk online. Okay, so let's say I will talk today about some results concerning the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system. And those results are obtained together with Pierangelo Marcati and Raffaele Scandone. So in particular, let's say I will mostly talk about this first paper, which is accepted now in Annali della Scuola Normale Superiore. And then, let's say, time permitting, I will also mention some things about the second preprint will hopefully appear online soon. And it will be related, let's say, to the fluid dynamical version, let's say, of the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system. Okay, but I will go to the details in a while. So first of all, let me introduce what is the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system. So many of you may know the canonical Maxwell Schrödinger system, which is a Schrödinger equation coupled with a wave equation for the electromagnetic potential. And let's say here, what we have is that the Schrödinger equation is augmented by a power type nonlinearity. So let's say we have, a nonlinear Schrödinger equation where the Laplacian is given by the covariant Laplacian, where A is the electromagnetic potential. And let's say that this wave function, this complex valued psi, evolves under the action of this electromagnetic potential, the electrostatic potential phi, and this nonlinear potential given by this power type nonlinearity. On the other hand, let's say this equation is coupled with the wave equation for the electromagnetic potential by this source term P of J, where J is the current density given by the formula on the right hand side, and P is the Helmholtz projection operator onto the divergence free vector fields. So indeed, let's say I directly wrote the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system in this way, meaning that I am just considering the system in the Coulomb gauge. And I did not mention the invariance with respect to the gauge transformation. And I will not talk about the other gauges that one can choose to study the problem. But let's say I will stick to this. And so please forgive me that I will not comment more about those things. So anyway, the system is Hamiltonian, in the sense that the physical quantities, like the total charge of the system and the total energy of the system, are conserved. So by the total charge, I mean the L2 norm of psi, and the total energy, you see, you have the kinetic energy, which is given by this covariant derivative, and then you have the action of all the other all the other, let's say, forces in the system are given by the electrostatic force, this nonlinear interaction, and then the part given by the electromagnetic potential. Okay, so why do you want to study some system like this one? Let's see. You know the canonical Maxwell-Schrödinger system, which is this one without the power-type nonlinearity, and this is widely studied in the literature. And you might wonder why you want to add some nonlinearity like this. And the reason, let's say, somehow is linked to the hydrodynamical formulation of the system. Maybe you might remember Piero's talk from yesterday, that he explained a bit of the relation between, let's say, nonlinear wave function dynamics with some quantum fluid dynamics. And the reason to study some systems like the nonlinear Maxwell-Schrödinger system arises if you want to study this kind of systems in quantum magnetohydrodynamics, which means that you basically consider a charged fluid, which is acting, let's say, under the action of a self-consistent electromagnetic force and a stress tensor, which is given by the usual pressure term and the quantum pressure, if you remember, let's say, the discussion from yesterday. And let's say, these kind of systems arise in some particular frameworks, like white dwarfs, in the cores of white dwarfs, or in some semiconductor device, or for in the description of quantum X-free free electron lasers, where basically you have some plasmas where basically which experience some quantum effects, and this is why you get this quantum term here. But let's say the important fact for us here for this talk, let's say, is the pressure term. So the for this kind of plasmas, of course, I mean, you have some pressure effects, some forces given by the pressure and indeed, let's say for this kind of quantum plasmas, the pressure is determined by basically the electron degeneracy of the fluid, in the sense that it's a kind of combination, let's say, roughly speaking, it's a kind of combination by the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and the Pauli exclusion principle. So basically, let's say you have that since two electrons, no more than two electrons, cannot stay in the same quantum state. So this means that this kind of creates a pressure between electrons. And this is described by this pressure. Okay, so for example, for the degenerate Fermi-Dirac plasmas, you have that the pressure is kind of asymptotic and given by this gamma law, let's say rho to the power d plus 2 over d, where d is the number of degrees of freedom of the system. So, and you see that this will be related to the nonlinearity in the nonlinear Schrödinger in the nonlinear Maxwell-Schrödinger system. And this indeed, let's say, if I just briefly recall what Piero was explaining yesterday, let's say, this is related, let's say, with the fact that given the wave function dynamics, give the hydrodynamical formulation of this by means of the hydrodynamical states, let's say rho and j. In particular, if you have the nonlinear Maxwell-Schrödinger system and psi and a are solutions to the nonlinear Schrödinger Maxwell-Schrödinger system, then rho j, e, and b defined in this way there are solutions, let's say formal solutions to the QMHD system. Now, what you see is that if in the wave function dynamics, you get some nonlinearity like this one, F prime depending on the square modulus of psi times psi, then you get a pressure term in the hydrodynamical formulation, which is given by this expression here. So which is rho F prime minus F of rho. And so for example, let's say if you think about this degenerate Fermi Dirac plasmas, what you would get in the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system would be exactly the mass critical nonlinearity, okay? But this is just one example, let's say. Then according to the different setups, you may have some other gamma laws for the pressure. Okay, anyway, so let's say this is why you want to study the Maxwell Schrödinger system. And let's say we focus on the Cauchy problem. And let's say, what are the main difficulties to study the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system? So here, let's say, I just wrote the, let's say the canonical Maxwell Schrödinger system in the sense that you see that some of the difficulties are already present in this system here. Then by adding a nonlinear, a power type nonlinearity, then this adds some further difficulties that we will discuss before. But basically what you have is that if you, let's say, unpack the magnetic Laplacian, you see that you have two main effects, let's say, which are ruling the evolution of the wave function. One is the dispersion given by the Laplacian, and the other one is the advection, let's say, which is given by this electromagnetic potential. And you see that there is now good interplay between those two phenomena. Actually, let's say you may see that for some special cases of the magnetic potential, you may also have some enhanced dispersion, actually, in the sense that there are some specific, some explicit electromagnetic potential for which the dispersion of this linear part is even better than the usual Schrödinger equation. But in general, let's say this is not true, especially if you're considering the magnetic potential A to be just a rough solution to this Maxwell equation, to the wave equation with source term P of J. And indeed, let's say in general, in this case, you do not even have the possibility to infer some Strigatz estimates for this kind of magnetic potentials. Moreover, let's say this basically, let's say, requires you to study the Cauchy problem in some higher regularity Sobolev spaces. This means that it is not easy to study the system here just in, let's say, in the energy space, but you want to do something in some higher regularity Sobolev spaces. And this indeed creates a further difficulty in a sense that once you get some local solutions in higher regularity Sobolev spaces, then when you want to extend the solution globally, then you would need some good a priori estimates. And since the only physical quantities which are conserved are given by the total charge and the total energy, let's say those are not sufficient to just to allow you to extend the solution globally, and you will need some other tricks. Okay, so as I told you, let's say the Maxwell Schrödinger system was widely studied, and let's say it goes back to some paper by Nakamitsu and Tsutsumi from 86, that some results for the Maxwell Schrödinger system are available. Actually, this first paper considered the Maxwell Schrödinger system in the Lorentz gauge, which was more convenient. And then, let's say there were many other results. So let's say I apologize because this is not a complete list of results. I just want to highlight some of those. For example, let's say this result by Guo, Nakamitsu, and Strauss from 95, where basically the authors show the existence of finite energy weak solutions of the Maxwell Schrödinger system in by using a vanishing viscosity argument. So let's say they consider the Maxwell Schrödinger system like this, and they add some viscosity. Let's say that the system becomes parabolic. You get some good estimates. You're able to control the advection term by just a perturbation argument, and then you're able to pass to the limit because you have some enough, let's say, compactness given by the total energy. Then those two papers by Nakamura and Bada, they study the local and global well-posedness of the system in a higher regularities of Hubble spaces. So more specifically, let's say if you, for example, if you consider some initial datum for psi in age 11 over 8, and some and the initial datum for the electromagnetic potential A0 in age let's say 1 plus something, then you know that there is a local solution, and then this was improved in this paper by in communication mathematical physics to the global one. And then let's say, let me also mention this paper by Bejanaro and Tataru, which actually they do have some let's say well-posedness result in the energy space. Even though let's say the this is not the usual let's say definition of well-posedness, in the sense that they are not able to prove the continuous dependence with respect to the initial data in the classical sense. And even let's say that the uniqueness is given just by, let's say, the solution, the finite energy solution that they show the existence. It's just the unique limit of some regular solutions. Then let's say many results also appeared about the scattering theory for the system. And let me also mention, let's say, this two last results about the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system. So let's say when you have the power type nonlinearity in the system, where in the first paper by in collaboration with Michele D'Amico and Piero Marcati, we only have some local well-posedness of the system. And a similar result appears in this paper by Colin and Watanabe, where actually, let's say, they even need some more regularity. But let's say, let me just point out that for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system, those two results, they only provide the local well-posedness in some higher regularities of Hubble spaces. What we are actually able to prove in this paper with Raffaele and Piero is the global well-posedness of the system. So more specifically, let's say we we consider a class of initial data defined by this M S sigma in the following. So let's say we put the wave function C in HS, and let's say A and B, you should think of as usual, let's say as A and the time derivative of A. So let's say A in a sigma in H sigma, and of course, I mean dt of A in H sigma minus one. And the theorem that you are able to prove is that for gamma between one and two and sigma between 4/3 and 3, then the Cauchy problem for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system is globally well posed in M to sigma. So, which means that for any initial datum, there exists a unique solution to the system. And this solution, let's say the blow up alternative, well, okay, the blow-up pattern that holds true, but as I told you, let's say the solution is global. And the solution, let's say, depends continuously with respect to the initial data. And moreover, let's say the physical quantities given by the total charge and the total energy are conserved for any time. Moreover, we can also prove some uniform bounds for the L infinity M to sigma norm of the solution over compact time interval. And this, as I told you, let's say, improves the local well-posedness results of the two papers that I mentioned before, okay? Now, let's say, how we proceed in the proof, let's say. What we need, of course, are just a priori estimates to set up a fixed point and solve the local Cauchy problem. And then we need some further estimates, let's say, to extend the solution globally. I mean, this is usual. Oops, I'm sorry. So first of all, what we need are the usual Strigatz estimates for the Klein-Gordon equation. Let me just recall it here. You may read it here. Let me just mention that for those estimates, let's say that the endpoint QR equals to infinity fails in general. But let's say this holds, for example, if you start with radial data, or if you want, you add some extra regularity on the angular direction of the data. Let's say I'm mentioning this because as you will see, let's say the L2 in time, L infinity in space estimate for the electromagnetic potential will be quite important in the following analysis. Then you need some nonlinear estimates, let's say, and so some estimates for the nonlinear terms, let's say. And of course, I mean, for the nonlinear Schrödinger part, those are the standard ones. And for the wave part, there is an interesting estimate, which let's say was exploited also by Nakamura and Bada for their local and global well-posedness result, which is the following one. It's just, let's say, a Kadopons type estimate. But the main, let's say, the smart fact about this estimate, if you see, let's say, that you have a gain of regularity in this kind of estimate, because the let's say the Helmholtz projection applied to a gradient is zero. So let's say you may move this gradient between C2 and C1 in such a way that you always put the function with the gradient in the Lebesgue spaces rather than in some Sobolev spaces, okay? And then the other main ingredient that you need to study this nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system is some Koch-Zvetkov type smoothing estimate. So this is, let's say, actually Koch and Zvetkov proved this kind of smoothing estimate for the Benjamin Owen equation. And then let's say also Nakamura and Bada adapted it to the Schrödinger evolutions. And the estimate looks like this. You see that, let's say, if you have some uniform bound on the solution of this linear Schrödinger equation of psi. So let's say if you know that psi is L infinity in time, ages in space. So actually you may get some space-time estimates for psi in the following way. So let's say the L2 in time, bs minus alpha 6-2. So let's say this is the usual best of space norm of psi. This is controlled by the L infinity norm, the L infinity in ths in space norm of psi, and the L2 in time hs minus 2 alpha in x space of f. So this means that if I choose alpha to be bigger or equal than 2, then a half, then let's say I'm able, let's say, to get some good a priori estimates also when I have the derivative term given by this the advection, let's say, which is a scalar grad. Okay, so in this sense, let's say I may use this smoothing estimate to get some good a priori estimates for the wave function itself. And indeed, let's say you may adapt this argument to infer some Coxvetkov type estimates also for the magnetic Schrödinger equation. In a sense that if you assume that the magnetic potential A belongs to some, let's say, Stricker spaces for the Klein-Gordon equation, then the same Coxvetkov estimate holds also for the magnetic evolution. Okay, so by using those estimates, basically, let's say you're able to prove the local well-posedness. And the local well-posedness goes like this. Let's say that for any gamma strictly greater than 1, and for sigma between 4/3 and 3, then the Cauchy problem, let's say, is local well-posed in M to sigma. So at this point, let me just mention that this restriction on sigma is actually motivated by the fact that we want the H2 regularity for psi. And this, well, let's say, will become clear later why we want the H2 regularity on psi. But let's say the same argument indeed can be refined. It can be, let's say, just adapted and can give you, let's say, the local well-posedness result also in the spaces M as sigma with S in, for example, up to 11 over 8 and sigma strictly greater than 1. We will not, let's say, focus on this refinement of the local theory, because as you will see, let's say, for the global theory, we will need the H2 solutions for the wave function, okay? And the local theory is, is a standard nowadays in the sense that we followed the approach by Nakamura and Wada. So it amounts to basically to infer some suitable a priori estimates for the solution and to establish, let's say, a fixed point argument by using those estimates. So let's say more specifically, what we are going to use are those two estimates, if you want, which is, let's say, that for the electromagnetic potential, you have this space-time Stricker's estimates, where on the right-hand side, you see that you have the bounds are given in terms of the initial data in the H sigma spaces. And let's say some uniform bound which, if you want, are given by the energy and the L infinity H2 norm of the wave function psi to some power M, let's say, which is something, let's say, which is not important. On the other hand, for the wave function, the L infinity H2 S norm can be estimated by what we have on the right hand side. In particular, let's say you see that we have some constant depending only on the initial data and then let's say the nonlinear estimate, which is dependent on the L6 L3 norm of DT of A. You see that 6-3 is a Klein-Gordon admissible pair. And indeed, let's say, this is exactly what gives you somehow the restriction on sigma, which needs to be greater or equal than 4/3, okay? And then let's say you have this further estimate. So let's say by exploiting those estimates, it is let's say straightforward to get the local word possibleness. Okay, now the problem is that once you get the local word possibleness in this way, of course, I mean, this is rather difficult to extend the solution globally in time. And of course, I mean, let's say the non-linearity, the power type non-linearity makes it even harder in this sense, in the sense that if you think about the Hartree non-linearity, which is, let's say, when you have the electrostatic potential acting on the wave function, then you see that for higher, let's say, Sobolev norms, anyway, you may control the nonlinear term in HS in, let's say, in a linear way with respect to the higher Sobolev norm. And of course, I mean, this cannot be possible for the power type nonlinearity, because otherwise, I mean, you would need some L infinity bound for Psi to do that. And you do not have it, or at least, let's say, if you just use the Sobolev embedding, then the estimate becomes nonlinear. And then, of course, I mean, you cannot globalize the argument by just a Gronwall type estimate. Indeed, this is the problem, let's say, with those kind of estimates, in a sense that you see that those estimates here are nonlinear on the right-hand side, on the higher Sobolev norms. So what you need to do then is you need to refine a bit this kind of estimates. And in particular, what you get is the following proposition, which is the following one. So let's say for a specific range of gamma, which is between 1 and 5 halves, and for S in between 1 and 2 sigma is critically greater than 1, then you see that the L2 in time, L infinity norm of A and L infinity norm H 7/6 in space norm of A are just bounded by a constant which depends on the initial data and on the energy, if you want. And the same, let's say, for the wave function, you get some estimate like this. So let's say the L2 in time W S minus a half 6 norm of Psi is bounded by the L infinity in time HS norm of Psi. So this means, for example, in particular, that if you pick S to be 1, then you see that the L2 in time W a half 6 norm of Psi is just uniformly bounded, because what you get here is just something which depends on the total energy and on the initial data, let's say. So this holds for any capital T up to the maximal time interval of existence. Let's say just to comment a bit the proof of this proposition. This is not just a straightforward application of the Cox-Fedkoff type smoothing estimates, in a sense that you need to do some bootstrap argument, in a sense that basically it goes like this. Somehow you first prove some good Strigatz estimates for the electromagnetic potential. By using this, you exploit those estimates to prove the Akkado-Svetkov, Koch-Svetkov type smoothing estimate for Psi, but up to some regularity delta. So let's say here, you wouldn't get the S minus a half regularity for Psi, but S minus a half minus something, minus delta regularity. Then, by using this, you may improve on the estimates for the electromagnetic potential A. And finally, let's say you get this L2 in time and infinity in space. And then by using this, you get up to this S minus a half regularity for psi. Okay, so let's say this is kind of a bit involved. It's not, super difficult, but anyway, you need some steps. They are not just immediate from the standard estimates of the nonlinear evolution, of the linear evolution, sorry. Okay, but let's see. Once you have this, then you may have some chances, let's say, of getting some uniform estimates over compact time intervals, okay? And this is what we are going to do after. So we split the proof of extending the solution globally in two cases. The first case is when we consider some lower gammas, let's say. So gamma between 1 and 3/2, let's say. And the second case is when gamma is between 3/2 and 2. If you remember, let's say the global well-posedness result was for gamma up to 2 included. For these lower values of gamma, what you do is just some energy estimates for the time derivative of the wave function. So let's say you have psi, you write down the evolution equation for dt psi, and you do some energy estimates here for dt psi, and what you get is that up to some constants, which just depend on the energy and the initial data, you get that the L infinity in time L2 in X norm of dt psi is bounded by, let's say, this dt of F, where F is the nonlinearity of the equation, and this term here. Now, let's say we see that this term here, dt of A times the covariant gradient of psi in L1, L2 is easily bounded once you know those estimates appearing in this proposition, and this is fine. Then for the nonlinear parts, what you have is an estimate like this. Let's say you do take the L infinity norm of psi out of this estimate. And here now you have this L infinity norm to the power 2 gamma minus 1. And here, what you want to do is to exploit a Brzezinski-Galois type inequality, which is the one which is written above. And by using this, you see that on this time integral, what you get is the W half 6 norm of psi to the power 2 gamma minus 1. And the logarithm of, let's say, the H2 norm of psi to the power 5 gamma minus 1/3. So you see that if gamma is in the range 1/3/2, then you're basically in business, in the sense that you put the logarithm and the L2 norm of dt psi out of the integral by the L infinity norm. And here, let's say, you integrate just the W half 6 norm of psi. And you see that for this range of gamma, then you may close the estimate by just a Grönwald argument. And let me just mention that this is not valid only for gamma in this range. You can improve a bit on this range. But for gamma between 3/2 and 2, as we will see next, you can use another argument. Anyway, you need to use this other argument. And this other argument, is given by considering a higher order entropy. So what? Basically, let's say you define this functional in the following way. And I highlighted the square modulus of dt psi in the sense that is the main part of the functional. So basically, let's say the other two terms in the functional here are just somehow some, let's say, lower order terms with respect to this square modulus of DTPC. So indeed, let's say, how can you get the function like this? You just take the L2 norm of DTPC, you differentiate it with respect to time. You see what you can do, and you see what you can put as under the time derivative. But okay, I will get to that in a while. Anyway, let's say you may use this higher order entropy in order to have some uniform bound on the solution. Indeed, this kind of argument is quite established in the literature. And it is also used for dispersive equations in many places. So let's say, I just mentioned the paper by Tsutsumi from 89 and the paper by Ozawa and Vishilia from 2015. And then let's say this paper by Planchon, Spetkov and Vishilia where they use let's say a similar functional to control the growth of Sobolev norms for the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, okay? Let me just also mention that somehow, say if you remember a bit of Piero's talk yesterday, you see that this functional may be written in a purely hydrodynamic form in the sense that then it will be related to the chemical potential. I'm just mentioning this in the sense that first of all, let's say this has a hydrodynamic interpretation, which, as you may understand, we do care about that. And on the other hand, this is also true that in the applied mathematics community, let's say these higher order entropies are widely used and they are quite well known. So let's say not only in the world of dispersive equations, so also in some other contexts. So this is why I wanted to emphasize this. Okay, so, but for this functional here, we have, let's say, those two main properties. First one is that somehow this functional is equivalent to the H2 norm of psi at mt. And this is given by the first estimate, you see. That this, the difference between the functional and the H2 norm of psi is basically controlled by a constant which depends on time times the H2 norm of psi itself to some power, C of gamma. And C of gamma is given here below. And then you see that if you differentiate this functional with respect to time, what you get is a bunch of terms, which I'm not writing down, but let's say somehow the main ones are given by those two terms here. Well, actually, let's say the first one you will always get there, and it's dt of a times this imaginary part of this thing. And, but this is, let's say, something somehow easy to control. And then this other term here, which is given by the modulus of C to the power two gamma minus three. And this is why you get the restriction gamma bigger or equal than 3/2 in this argument here, times the square modulus of the covariant gradient of C times dt of the modulus of C. So you see, let's say that remember that the main part of the functional which was given by dt psi squared, okay? So this means that in this time derivative here, you want to put this dt psi and dt psi here out of the estimate. And you see that the main thing that you want to do to control this time derivative is to estimate what remains here in L1 in time, L2 in space, okay? So as I told you, this estimate here is pretty easy. Let's say this may be done in the same way as we did as we did here, basically. So let's say here, where we basically used just those uniform estimates here. On the other hand, for this nonlinear estimate here, we need to work a bit, but at the end of the day, what you get is something like this, that the L1, L2 norm of this nonlinear term here is bounded by a constant, which depends on the time and the total energy, times the L infinity H2 norm to the power 1 minus epsilon. And this epsilon depends on gamma in this way. And you see, they say that now, if you put this estimate here, so let's say just as a comment, of course, I mean, the rest of the terms appearing here, let's say, are easier or comparable to those two other terms. So let's say once you know how to estimate those two terms, then basically you're done. So let's say if you plug those estimates inside here, then you just may apply a Grunwald type argument somehow, and you get some good estimate for this functional E2. More precisely, let's say for gamma between 3/2 and 2, let's say strictly less than 2, you get some polynomial bounds in time for this function. This is somehow exactly the same argument used in the paper by Planchon, Spetkov, and Bisciglia. And for gamma equals 2, you get some exponential bound in time. And let's say once you have this, you're done. Because once you have this, you know that the H2 norm of psi at time t is uniformly bounded on any compact interval. And as a consequence, you may get also some uniform bounds on the H sigma minus one norm of A dt A. This will be uniform over compact time interval. And then let's say you're done, because this means that your solution exists globally. And this is it. So let's say this somehow ends the proof of the global Wolff-Posenness for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrödinger system. Now let's say I would like to Raffaele.
Sorry, Paolo, we lost you for maybe 30
minutes.
Yeah, one minute.
Okay, let's say, and the proof is over. No, I'm joking. Let's say, sorry. I don't know where I left you, but somehow what I was saying is that once you know how to control those terms here, then you may use a Grunwald type argument for this entropy functional E2. Okay. And what I was specifying was only that for gamma strictly less than 2, you would get uniform bounds for this functional in the sense that on any compact time interval, this functional is bounded and the bound is polynomial in time. Whereas for gamma equals 2, the bound is exponential in time. Okay. Once you get those uniform bounds over compact time interval, you know that your solution is global. So I hope I didn't lose much. So let's see, Raffaella, how much time do I have? Hello?
Around 5 minutes, Paolo.
Ah, okay, that is fine, that is fine. I just want to, let's see. I just want to mention how those things are related to some systems in quantum fluid dynamics, okay? So I'm sorry for the repetition, but let me just make some resume of the theory for the QHT systems, okay? Just to understand where are we, okay? So usually, let's say the prototype of the QHT system is something like this. You have an equation for the mass density rho, an equation for the momentum density rho v, which is j. And what you have, let's say the equation is for rho is the continuity equation. the balance equation for J or B is something like this, where you had this strange term, which was explained thoroughly by Piero yesterday, which is the quantum term. Nevertheless, this system is Hamiltonian. The total energy is given by this functional here, and it is formally conserved along the flow of solution. Then what? Well, if you want to establish a rigorous, let's say, theory for solutions of the QHD system in the energy space, at least, what you do is you rewrite the quantum term in the following way, so that somehow everything is well defined by the terms which appear in the energy. Okay, and then what you do is you consider everything in terms of this pair given by this hydrodynamic state, which is square root of rho and lambda. And by means of those objects, you define the solution of the QHD system in the same in the following way. So let's say the mass density rho, which is just will just be the square of this square root. And J, the momentum density, would be just the product between square root of rho and this lambda. Somehow you see that lambda is morally square root of rho times B. So let's say this is why the convective term here, rho B cross B, will become lambda cross lambda, okay? And now how you exploit the nonlinear Schrodinger equation? Well, you exploit it by using the polar factorization in a sense that this was already explained by Piero yesterday, no? That for any complex valued function psi in H1, you may find a polar factor phi such that this identity holds almost everywhere. And then you may define the hydrodynamic state in this way. So let's say the square root of rho, which is will just be the absolute value of psi, and the lambda will be the imaginary part of the conjugate of the polar factor times grad psi. Then the important fact is that, of course, I mean, the grad of square root of rho is nothing but the real part of phi bar grad psi, but you have this bilinear identity. Okay, now, by using this fact, you may find finite energy weak solutions to the QHD in the following way. You have some finite energy solution to the nonlinear Schrodinger equation, psi, in this way. Then you construct those hydrodynamic states, square root of rho and lambda, as I did in the previous slide. And this somehow define a finite energy weak solution. So let's say I will not get into details of this. I just want to highlight some ideas of the proof of this fact, in a sense that the one of the main things which are needed here is that you're considering the nonlinear Schrodinger equation, which is a very good equation in the sense that it has a well-established well-posedness theory and stability theory. More precisely, what you have is that the nonlinear equation enjoys the continuous dependence with respect to the initial data, persistence of regularity, and stability with respect to the perturbation of the nonlinearity. Okay? So this means that by exploiting those facts, so by having strong solutions to the NLS and the stability properties, you may get the existence of weak solutions to the QHD. Now, let's say for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrodinger system, what we did so far was that for some initial data in M2 sigma and sigma A was greater or equal than 4/3, then we have a global solution, okay? So the question would be, well, if we do have such a regular solutions for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrodinger system, can we get some more regularity also for the hydrodynamical states? And indeed, let's say the answer is negative in general, but let's say this is kind of working project at the moment. And the other question is that, okay, so you see for the QHD system, what you have is that for some finite energy initial data, square root of rho zero, lambda zero, you do know that there exists a global in time finite energy solution to the QHT system, okay? What happens for the QMHT system? So let's say for the QHT system with magnetic potential determined by the Maxwell equations. Can we do the same? Of course, I mean, we cannot just exploit the global well-posedness theory I just told you about, because in order to do this, we will need some more regularity for the initial data, of course. So, yes, okay, so let's say last two slides, sorry for the delay. So let's say, just to present the result about the QMHT system, let's say, let me just recall it and let me give you this definition, in the sense that I say that rho zero J zero E zero B zero is an S sigma admissible datum for the QMHT system if they are associated to some initial data for the nonlinear Maxwell Schrodinger system at the regularity M S sigma, okay? So the goal would be to get just a finite energy, but of course, I mean, we cannot. But nevertheless, let's say we're almost at that kind of regularity, in a sense that if we assume sigma strictly greater than one, then for any one sigma admissible initial datum, there exists a finite energy weak solution to the QMHT system. Okay, so let's say very few comments about the proof of this. Of course, I mean, we cannot follow the proof that we exploited for the QHT system, and we need to do some other things. And the main ideas in this proof are basically two. And the first one being that we exploit the integral formulation of the nonlinear Maxwell Schrodinger system, given by the UMS formula. And the second main idea is that we need to refine quite well the a priori estimates we already got for weak solutions to the nonlinear Maxwell Schrodinger system, in a sense that we then need to localize them in space and get some more information at rough regularity rather than just the let's say local global well-posedness framework. Okay, so let's say I will stop here because I think the time is over, and I thank you for the patience, and that's it.
Thank you, Paolo, for the talk. Let's see if we have some online question. Please, you can just unmute yourself and ask. No. Fine, you're in the room. We have some question. Vladimir, yes.
Paolo, can you hear me?
Yes. I can hear you. Not very well.
I can repeat the question. Or yes. You can.
So what is it? Sorry.
So can you hear me now?
Yes. I mean, it's the connection, I guess, that is not really stable.
Yes, but the connection.
Please tell me.
Imagine you have focus instead of focusing, and yeah. You take small, for example, you can have Maxwell, so net field is zero, main enemy is zero. So perturbation, do you expect to have global solution?
Okay, so let's say, Vladimir, sorry, but the connection is really unstable. Let me see if I got your question. Please. If you have a focusing nonlinearity, yeah. Then can you do something, let's say, for global solution and small initial data, let's say, with small initial data? Yes,
but around ground states, around ground states.
Okay. Yeah, it's an interesting question. I mean, I went back to this page because there are some other papers by Colin and Watanabe. So this is about the Cauchy problem. But then those two guys, they studied also the existence of standing waves in the focusing case, exactly. So let's say they do have some existence results for standing waves for focusing nonlinearities. I do not know, actually, I'm sorry about that. I do not know if they also prove some kind of stability, instability result of those waves. But besides this, let's say, your question is interesting. And indeed, it would be interesting to see what happens for some standing waves. Yeah.
Thank you, Paolo. And we shall discuss. Thank you.
Okay.
So, all the online participants of today, and the state power. Okay, we resume tomorrow morning at the same time, yes, 20 past time.